HarperCollins presents Food of the Cods, How Fish and Chips Made Britain, by Daniel Gray, read by George Reid. Introduction. I would not be alive if fish and chip shops had never existed. Early in the 1920s, Laura March, not yet out of her teens, was working in the family chippy on Bank Street in Wetherby, near Leeds. In the queue that evening waited Fred Gray, a miner from Aberford, 8 miles down the road. Eyes met over the frying range, caught and sizzled into marriage, and my granddad was born in 1925. It would be opportune to say that this tale spurred my lifelong love of all things fish and chips, but, in fact, I discovered it only while writing this book. Instead, I remember Laura, my great-grandmother, for three things: that we called her Granny Grunt for being miserable, that she lived on Parsons Green, where the street sign's letter P always used to go missing, and that she would always sellotape a £1 coin in the left-hand corner of birthday cards, which incidentally she signed Granny Grunt. This, though, is not some kind of family memoir. We are not interesting enough. Just very Yorkshire. Childhood memories do occasionally meander across its pages, as is probably inevitable for most of us when it comes to fish and chips. The dish carries a sentimental weight, and a happy one. It is part of our collective and individual folklore and identity. Those lost chippies we fondly recall from the past, or a side dish or sauce particular to the area we grew up in but left. What follows is a book written from Fred's side of the counter rather than Laura's. It is about the delights of being a customer and a diner, although every story told and place visited is underpinned by owners, fryers, servers, and the glorious shops they keep. This is for those of you who know the joy of a parent declaring chippy night, of seeing the golden glow of a chip shop on a dark evening, or of feeling a sudden pang of hunger when in range of its blissful scents. It is about piles of bread rolls, or cobs, or baps, or whatever they're called where you're from, on the counter beside giant jars of pickled things, about wooden forks, polystyrene tubs of mushy peas the colour of snooker tables, and fridges of fizzy drinks rarely seen in other places, and about answering the key questions of salt and vinegar, or open or wrapped. It is about eating outside on a cold winter's night, cradling the paper's warmth, or sneaking a chip on the way home. I wanted to write an homage to those feelings and experiences, as well as answer questions and seek out the endearing idiosyncrasies of chippies. For example, I knew scraps, gorgeous tiny clippings of batter offcuts, scooped from the frying range and sprinkled on chips or munched alone, are not served in Scotland. But where is their southern border? I had a desire to learn about, and yes, taste, the many regional variations of food on offer from chip shops across Britain. And I wished to sketch out the dish's social history, showing how chippy culture has influenced us and been swayed by its surroundings. In the debated story of how fish and chips came to be can be found themes of immigration, race, war, class, women's equality, and local and national identity. Among these wider narratives sit the parts of history I love the most. The anecdotes of Geordie kids using their gas masks to hold fish and chips, or a Humberside chippy vending machine operated by a man pretending to be a robot. This book is not a comprehensive history, of which there have been two extremely valuable versions: Professor John K. Walton's Fish and Chips and the British Working Class, and Fish and Chips, A Takeaway History, by Professor Panikos Panayi. Nor is it a guide to the finest chippies, a delve into the sustainability of fishing, or a survey of potato types. At no point do I address health or dietary concerns. When chippy night is called, all that must go out the window. Look away now if you're expecting the work of a food critic. The book does not contain restaurant reviews, and I have eschewed pointed nitpicking of chippies and their products. Theirs is a hard enough job without some amateur possessing an unhealthy obsession with scraps putting the boot in. Of course, I have had bad fish and chips, sometimes in researching this book, but this is fundamentally a celebration. The sense of this being an arduous trade to operate was especially true in the period when I undertook my travels. A combination of post-Brexit supply chain difficulties, a shortage of cheap raw materials resulting from the war in Ukraine, and severe energy cost rises made running a chip shop more difficult than ever. Consequently, chippies were closing at a saddening and alarming rate. The National Federation of Fish Fryers warned of potentially an extinction event for small businesses. For customers, the central repercussion was a stark increase in the price of this traditionally affordable treat. Even takeaway fish and chips had, in many places, climbed above the psychologically sacrosanct £10 barrier. This troubled backdrop provided compelling motivation for travelling and writing. More than ever, I felt a determination to cherish and champion this food and these places. I wanted to let daylight in upon magic, considering and then explaining the sorcery behind fish and chips, and to show that our chippies retain resilience and vigour. This will be a love letter, not a eulogy. Moreover, it is far from controversial to assert that our country's recent past has been somewhat fractious. In something as seemingly frivolous as fish and chips, I saw an emblem and an industry that symbolised shared belonging and collectivism. In a time of so much sound and fury, this had to be a story worth pursuing. Although my journey for this book started on the east coast of Scotland, my chippy odyssey really began in the North Yorkshire village I grew up in, Copmanthorpe. As a child, my friends and I would sit on a low wall outside Bill's. No food tasted so divine as the scorching fish and chips we ate on those cold evenings, often as a second sneaky tea, steam rising into the black sky. There followed other pillar and staging post chippies. After Middlesbrough football matches, my dad would take me to the Essex Street shop in that town, its windows forever glazed with fried heat. "Any fish tonight?" the fryer would ask as we entered. Always a good sign, along with a queue, as it meant freshly prepared food. When I later became a dad myself, going for fish and chips came to be something my daughter and I did together from a very young age. She is a teenager now, but still a wave of preposterous pride washes over me when she begs for a trip to the chippy. Here, then, is one man's take during a looped journey across Scotland, England and Wales in the spring and summer of 2023. There will be omissions. Readers may well sigh in disbelief that their beloved chip shop or speciality dish has been missed. Therein, though, is the charm of this meal. We care about it with an almost alarming intensity. This book is an attempt to recapture that village wall feeling several times over, without significant weight gain. It is an expression of what fish and chips mean to me, and to so many of us. Few places feel as promising as the queue outside a chippy. This book ponders why. Pass the salt, will you? Chapter 1. Pea Busters and Grampian Tempora. Dundee and Stonehaven. As the train shuffled towards Dundee, its conductor made a confession. The 40-something man had one great regret, he said, about having moved from Grimsby to rural Aberdeenshire. "They don't batter their fish cakes," he told a couple of pensioners. "Imagine that." The pair looked as if this remarkable concept was indeed within their powers of imagination, And so, he continued. I went into the chippy, I said. You've got batter. You've got fish cakes. Please, batter a fish cake for me. His plea had initially been met with resistance. We don't do that here, they said, before a deal was brokered. Now, as soon as they see me coming in on a Friday, they batter two for me. It was clear that this mattered to the conductor, and had even played a small part in helping him resettle. A taste of his old home had made him feel more comfortable in his new. Batter acting as a soother and a lasso dragging Humberside and Aberdeenshire closer. It surprised me that a Scottish fish and chip shop would not normally batter its fish cakes. After almost 2 decades of living north of the border, I'd concluded that there was no foodstuff these outlets would not smother and then deep fry. To look into the display cases of frying ranges here is to see a bronze and flaxen menagerie of edible breeds in shapes oblong and octagon, triangle and tubular. Sometimes, haddock lounge among them, left to bathe in the luminous heated light all day so that their ends curl up like those of Christmas cracker fortune-telling fish in the palm of a hand. Other battered species include burgers of beef and chicken, sausages, jumbo and small, or smoked and saveloy, white pudding and black pudding, and occasionally something called red pudding, haggis and king ribs, and mock chops and chip steaks, fritters of potato and pineapple, spam and polony, onion rings, pakora and margarita pizzas. This tendency to cloak so many items in batter, as if assimilating them into one crispy family, has become ingrained in Scottish culture. Deep fry your pizzas. We're gonna deep fry your pizzas, sang members of the Tartan Army when travelling to watch the Scotland national football team play in Italy during the 1990s. My early impressions of Scottish fish and chip shops, or fish and chicken bars, as they were and are commonly subtitled, echoed this ethos of choice and variety. The chippies I had grown up with in Yorkshire offered a limited and Spartan single-board menu of fish, sausages, and the odd, wildly hedonistic extra, such as a potato scallop. Here, entire walls were required to catalogue the exotic offerings, with each item accompanied by two prices, single or supper. That word, supper, summoned two confusing interpretations. Firstly, of a pre-bedtime bowl of shreddies in front of the telly as a child, and secondly, what I'd heard well-spoken people call the tea. Neither impression, perhaps drawn from both ends of the social class spectrum, proved correct. Supper simply meant with chips. This bountiful approach extended beyond the frying ranges. There, hoarded on neatly curated shelves, were shimmering chocolate bars and sweets, biscuits and bubblegum. Next came sentry lines of cigarettes and Rizzler papers, 4 packs of lager and 0.5 litres of vodka, then blended whiskies and wines no one was ever drunk enough to try. In whirring fridges, glass bottles of Iron Brew, Red Cola, limeade and cream soda were accompanied by more widely spotted cans of pop, or juice here, and sometimes ginger, and milkshakes. Arriving in Scotland, after a lifetime of chippies in which retailing both Vimto and Tizer counted as edgily excessive, made you feel like a Soviet-era Muscovite recently deposited in New York. As if all of that were not discombobulating enough, and contrary to this country's apparent batter epidemic, another bewitching fact struck me. Scottish chippies neither made nor offered scraps. Scraps. Those brittle, dreamy morsels of delight. Scraps, a form of edible confetti perfect for scattering over chips. Scraps, that joyous ballast to be loaded into a vice made from buttered slices of white bread, I wondered how I could ever settle.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.